especially in regards to the show, do have friends in the media industry, especially in the music industry. And what I've noticed a common trend is that these individuals who know these stars, these rap artists, best, that know them well, is that they're some of the nicest people ever, that they would never, that their lyrics are do not represent their essence, their personalities at all. And, you know, even though they may go on stage and talk about doing this and doing that and doing this and doing that, just like you said, Miss Fleming Smith, these people would never in a million years. And that is the one common trend that, like I said, that all of that of my business associates, you know, do that work with these stars have told me, is that they're not those people on stage. They're the girls in their videos. They don't go home with them. They, you know, they might have the you know, I guess they might have the loose chick with her, you know, with her breast out or with her, you know, with her behind hanging out. But at the end of the day, they go home to the more conservative, you know, or respectable. You know, they come home to Betty or Barbara or, you know, Jan, if you will. And I'm using those terms in a euphemistic way, if you will, in that they come home to the respectable women who wear clothes, who, you know, who don't sit on top of cars, you know, with, you know, with water hoses on them. They don't come home those type of women. Those are just the women that are in their videos.
But you don't see that.
But you're right.
And we need to see what the reality is. Mm-hmm. You know, because, you know, it's so easy to glamorize all of it and to say like, oh, well, that's what the norm is. Well, that doesn't have to be the norm. Mm-hmm. And it isn't the norm. It's the stereotype. It's what you're buying into, and it's not the reality. And reality is so much better.
And even reality is not reality.
Reality, exactly.
Reality is not reality. Because they try to say reality TV is the real deal, but
it can't possibly.
No. Too. Yeah. You can't pay somebody. How are you going to pay somebody to live their life?
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? When you tell that person signs on that line, and then you say, mm-hmm. I'm going to write you a check for this many episodes for this season, but mm-hmm. you have to act the way we tell you to.
Mm-hmm. Or we're at least going to edit it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah.
We're gonna add the drama because that's what sells.
Basketball.
And you know, we just gotta have better expectations than this, and we just gotta raise it up.
And I just feel another thing with these reality shows, The Real Housewives of Atlanta, Basketball Wives, Football Wives, these are the women that are in young women's faces all the time.
Exactly.
All the time. And you know what? At the reunions, they don't even talk rationally as ladies. They're cursing at each other and arguing without even hearing the other person's side. It takes 10 to 15 minutes for each one of these ladies to calm down to actually hear the person act civilized. And then we get our young women to look at this and say, okay, these women are on TV, but I want to be on TV. I want that life too. So do exactly. I have to act like that? I want that life. And when do we put out the respect, the Jans, the Bettys?
Let's definitely respect them. Let's
Barbaras.
The Barbaras.
Yes.
Let's put Barbara out. Let's put a show with Barbara, the conservative girl, the respectable girl, the one that takes care of the house and herself.
And her job.
Mm-hmm. And her job.
Yeah.
I know so. I
And not just walk around town looking good.
Exactly.
Spending money. Half, with cameras yeah, following them. Yeah.
Half of these housewives shows aren't even housewives.
Yeah. Exactly. They're house.
They're just there.
Yeah.
Just there.
They're exes. And
We just have to do better. We just mm-hmm. have to do better. And, you know, just media in general, we have to do better.
But they're going to do what sells.
Exactly.
They're going to do what sells, and that's what's going.
And the idea is, too, is like, what happens, though, if we look away? You know, what happens? So, and there's a huge conversation all about media right there.
What do you all think, Miss Fleming Smith? Do sexual assaulters, individuals who have been sexually assaulted in their lives, whether it was as children or as young adults, do you notice that a lot of them grow up to become sexual assaulters themselves, or no?
Well, I think that you run a higher risk if you've been perpetrated against as a child or molested as a child to becoming a perpetrator yourself. But that's not to say that all children out there who are molested are going to become molesters or become, you know, going to become perpetrators of violence. You know, that's not the case. That would be like saying that every child that witnessed domestic violence was going to become a domestic violence perpetrator. Do we have that? Yes. But every child? No. So we have to look at that and and kind of watch out for that. And because the thing is that we do have something called sexually reactive children. And these are children that have been molested and now are perpetrating themselves, usually against younger children. And, that's a horrible, horrible experience. And it's because now you're not only dealing with, a child that's been victimized, but now you're dealing with a child who is victimizing. Mm. And that takes a lot of therapeutic care it's a challenge in our area to find therapists who can work specifically with the population. So, it's a huge ordeal.
Also, college age groups. Would it be safe to say that this is the age group 18 to 25? This is the age where a lot of these a significantly high number of sexual assaults, sexual violence issues.
There
occur.
Is. I think the latest statistics that I was looking at is that 1 in 4 or 1 in 5 female college students would become victimized by a sexual assault. Yeah, huge, huge numbers of people reporting this. And I in my professional experience, working with victims that most tend to be in the 15 to 25 area, but that's not to say that all of them aren't. The youngest victim I've ever worked with was 6, and the oldest was 65. So it's when you're looking at it, sexual assault can be an across the board crime. It can happen at any age, but it does seem to really be higher numbers for this college age population. And I personally wonder if that's because we really work so hard to really bring out information to kids younger and younger. Like, let's talk about sexual assault. Let's talk about, it's okay to tell. But also I think there's, college age kids have more access to the number one date rape drug, alcohol. And, I think that's definitely in a situation there too.
Why? As far as college age groups are concerned, why do you think, I know you said that because there's access to drugs and alcohol, especially in an environment like that. You and I were discussing earlier how it's a potential you could be faced with more drugs and sex and alcohol, all those things that lead to sexual violence. You could be faced with more of that in the 4 years or 5 or 6, however long you remain at your respective institution. Here's a possibility you could be faced with more in those couple of years than you would in your entire adult life.
Oh yeah.
And it's a part of it is it's kind of funny, but it's kind of not. It's funny, like, wow, that's crazy. But at the same time, it's scary, like, wow, that's crazy. I think a part of that goes back to what we've talked about on the show before, especially when we did our College Freshman in America show just a couple of months ago back in February. There's that sense of freedom, liberation. Woo! I'm away from mommy and daddy. Woo! I'm on my own. That maturation process is just setting in, and you're trying to experience what it's like being an adult. So you want to do everything you possibly can in the quickest amount of time possible. And I think sometimes that may lead to irresponsible decisions in which things such as sexual violence can take place, because all you're thinking about is what you can do, and how much of it you can do and how quickly you can do it. And unfortunately, that's not to say, and we want to make sure we're very clear, that's not to say that it's that person's fault. We want to make sure we don't never, ever, ever blame the victim. But I think we're more discussing how it gets to that point in that those kinds of things take place.
Certainly, you know, college age, you have more access to, you know, situations that could be potentially dangerous. And we've talked about safety. You know, we've talked about that tonight, and, you know, about and poor choices, and, you know, but the consequence should never be rape. And that's, you know, when we're talking about consent and alcohol, that's big. And when you're talking about, you know, the fact if somebody is drunk, they are not able to give consent. If someone is high, they are not able to give consent. And even if they are drunk and are high and they say yes, you can't accept that because they are under the influence and nothing they say equals consent. So that is a big thing for folks to kind of swallow sometimes. Well, she said yes. Well, was she drunk? Yeah. Well, then she didn't actually say yes. You should have listened to her saying that, you know, that you taken to a point what was going on in that situation.
Also, and one more question, and we're going to go to a commercial break here. What about in regards to, let's just say if that person, they've had sex in the past, and it could have been great sex in the past, and let's say that person meets up with them sometime later and they have not had any sexual encounters with one another in a while. How does that work? As far as the other individual maybe saying no.
I think, Trace, correct me if I'm wrong, you still have to have consent, because you can consent to one form of sex or consent to sex this day and then the next day you don't consent to it. Just because you get consent that one time does not mean that counts for every time. You need that consent every time.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, a person's body is not a convenience store. Mm-hmm. They are not available 24 hours a day. Not Walmart. Not open 24 hours a day. You know, consent has to be given each and every time. And a person could be dating, they could be married, they could be together for a long time. You know, they could have sex, you know, every now and then, you know, just hookups. But just because you had sex once doesn't mean that you have to ever have sex again. So you have, you know, consent absolutely has to get given each and every time.
Yeah, that is definitely true, because a lot of people don't know that just because you consent to one form of sex doesn't mean that you consent to another form of sex. I know that's something that we've discussed. Mm-hmm. In the counseling services department, that a lot of people don't know that if I consent to doing this with you, it doesn't mean that you can do the rest of this. So that's another reason that may go back to why they don't report it.
And that's why it's so important to know where your line is with consent, mm-hmm. you know, because that line can change and can change from each person, can change to each situation. You know, you have to, like we talked about, if you're mature enough to have sex and you're mature enough to talk about sex, mm-hmm. and be vocal with your partner about what you're willing to do and what you're not willing to do and be upfront about that. Yeah. But also probably to listen when somebody says yes or no, too.
Yes, and to listen carefully.
Yes.
Yes, and make sure you're hearing what it is that you think that you are hearing. And, you know, I'm so glad that, you know, we have people like the three of you all who are able to come and openly talk about this and make this discussion amongst men and women, you know, because sexual assault, as we've discussed, happens to everybody of all ages, of all races, of all economic statuses, whether you're rich, whether you're poor, living in the boondocks, whether you live in, you know, middle class America, it happens. And I'm glad that we were able to sit down and have such wonderful, educated conversation in regards to this. Is there anything else that you all would like to close out with before we go to this commercial break?
Well, I'd like to just share with everyone the RAIN national hotline number. And for anyone who is here in the program tonight and needs to talk to an advocate, you know, this is some triggering stuff, or, you know, maybe it's the first time somebody wants to share their story. You know, RAIN has a great resource. It's the National Sexual Violence Hotline. It's 1-800-656-HOPE. And, you know, it's available 24 hours a day. You can call that number and it will go through to your nearest rape crisis center. That's important information.
And it's confidential.
And it's absolutely confidential. And that, you know, so it's 1-800-656-HOPE.
Yes, ma'am. And I'm just looking here, as a matter of fact, on the RAIN website, the Rape, Abuse, and Incest National Network. And it seems like, you know, you all have great programs great programs here, especially considering the fact that it is the month of April, Sexual Assault Awareness Month. So, yes, make sure you all take advantage of that. Again, the National Sexual Assault Hotline is 1-800-656-4673. Again, it is free, confidential, and available 24/7. When we come back, we have some events that we are going to advertise for the local students here in the Jacksonville State Area Community. For all you listeners listening nationwide, you can still tune in if you would like. We're going to advertise some local events that are going on here on the campus of Jacksonville State University, where we are broadcasting from. It is 47 minutes past the hour, and we'll be right back after this commercial break.